Thank you, Sylvia. Finalement, je donne la parole à Sarana Sandy, CEO de Skills for Change. Sarana Sandy, the CEO of Skills for Change, it's your turn.
Thank you very much, Peter. Good morning, everyone. First, thank you, ONN and AFO, for gathering this data and shining a light on the impact of COVID-19, in particular on the nonprofit sector. It's been very devastating. So Skills for Change is a charity. We are located in the Greater Toronto Area, Hamilton Wentworth Region, Toronto, multiple offices, Markham, Peel. And COVID-19 has had specific impact on our internal, but also on our clients and their access to service and the impact on the ability to fully live their lives here in Toronto. So we provide services to immigrants and refugees and Canadians, including employment services, language settlement services, and academic bridging program. And COVID-19 in particular has devastating impact on our clients because a lot of our clients are racialized and low income and new to Canada. So the impact has been felt in various different ways. In particular, technology access issues. So one of the challenges is COVID-19 hit and the emergency declaration and having to go and do remote program delivery. A lot of our clients were unable to access the service because of lack of technology, because of not having cell phone data, and the costs associated with it meant that a lot of people who had great needs could not access services, and so they were left behind, which is a real, real challenge. And that impact is far reaching, right? You know, language training. So when you have 5 to 6 months of not having access to learning English in order to enter the labor market or access post-secondary education, or to be able to engage in a community and, you know, take care of your children in terms of interfacing with teachers and caregivers and healthcare professionals, it really negatively impacts your lives. From an employment standpoint, we work a lot with employers and it's incredibly devastating. We serve about 20,000 clients per year and a bulk of them related to employment access. And not having access to employment, not having access to the labor market is really a challenge, both emotional and of course financial for our clients. And of course, when we look at the other big challenge for us is that we have childcare service delivery. And the ability to access childcare and to, you know, learn a language or go to an entrepreneurship training or attend a workshop without the burden of a cost of childcare and access to good childcare, it really frees people up to pursue their needs. And so not being able to offer childcare for our clients pull them back. And also as we go forward with reopening in October, we would have limited access to childcare. So that means that a lot of our clients will not be able to partake in job search, partake in language training, partake in additional skills development training because they don't have those pieces. Looking at our organization, you know, as a nonprofit, we have limited resources. And looking back what Kathy highlighted, it's almost as though she was speaking about Skills for Change and all of the particular challenges that are faced. But in particular, being able to have the technological infrastructure to deliver adequate quality programming is very expensive. And as a nonprofit, we don't usually have access to funds and tools in order to develop those complex technology infrastructure to support clients. So we cobble together as best we could, as we always do in this sector. You create from nothing. You innovate to ensure that service delivery is there. But what we really require and the broader support and looking at, you know, the fund for the sector is if we're supposed to continue to deliver programming and modify the way we deliver said programming, we do need that investment from our government funding partners to support the sector in order to do that very well. And then that would mean that our end users will be able to access the services that are critical to their needs. We provide mental health issues, and we saw a dramatic uptake in the access to mental health supports. In particular, when we look at our women clients, and so we provide mental health, wellness, and employment, and language training, and entrepreneurship specifically to women population, in addition to, you know, men and youth and seniors. But some areas that we identified as COVID impact on women clients in particular include increase isolation, obviously, well, you know, we can see that anecdotally, but in particular, a difficulty in accessing services, as I referenced earlier, in terms of technology, in terms of being taking care of their children, because a lot of them have children, and being able to even partake in the services. Increased stress and anxiety due to the fear of COVID itself. And then, of course, having children at home and how that increases the burden and emotional toll on women. But we have seen also an increase in intimate partner violence for our female clients. And of course, not being able to access services because they are also stuck at home with their abusers. So we need a lot more investment. And we've seen some, but we need a lot more investments in this particular area. And then, of course, for women, loss of employment. I mean, we know huge unemployment. But again, if you compound the other mental health issues, intimate partner violence issues, loss of connection, social isolation, and loss of financial independence, it is incredibly devastating. So one of the things I wanted to speak to today also is what should the government do in supporting women in particular at Skills for Change and across Ontario. We need a lot more immediate investment in childcare and childcare resources so that especially low-income and racialized women can have adequate childcare so that they can pursue employment and training in order to live their lives fully. Financial supports, increased financial supports as we look at other federal supports that may be winding down so that the individuals can have that. Financial supports for the clients and financial supports for nonprofits are supporting those clients so that we can adequately ensure our organizations, the infrastructure, the health resources that are necessary, the equipment for staff are there so that it can provide good service in a safe, effective manner. A lot more concrete investment in mental health and wellness support for families and individuals, as I think that is, we need a concrete dedicated investment line for that. We need more investment in employment programs that are specific to helping women into good, decent jobs, not just minimum wage jobs, but good, decent jobs. And more education and training for reskilling and upskilling of women in particular. And of course, what's missing in Ontario, I think is really critical, is more flexibility for sick days and more access to sick days and work schedules within the Employment Standard Act. I think we need a lot more flexibility there so that women can access the labor market, but in a way that they can take care of themselves and their families in such a way that it does not create additional mental stress and burden on them and financial impact. And as a nonprofit organizations, I think, you know, we've consistently struggled and make do. I think it's about time that there's broader investment so we can do more. And we want to be able to leverage those resources. And yes, as Kathy identified through the survey data, we're collaborating more effectively. We're working really well with each other, but we're working with very limited resources. And so the kind of impact, the deeper, greater impact that we can make for our community so that we can better deal with this social, health, and economic crisis that we're going through is really dependent on deeper investments in nonprofits. We are core to Ontario. We are core to Ontario's social infrastructure, economic infrastructure, health infrastructure. And without adequate investment and support, we are going to see a very, very different Ontario as we continue with more burdens in terms of poverty and mental health issues and lack of labor market attachment for people who do need as much as they can into the labor market so that they can have financial independence. So thank you for coming today and getting that context as to what nonprofit organizations are going and our clients. And thank you, Kathy, and thank you, Peter, thank you, Carol, and thank you everyone else who put together this data so we can get some context.
Thank you, Sarana. And I want to take a moment to thank Sylvia and Sarana for sharing a picture of the impacts of COVID-19 on their organizations and sharing what dozens and probably hundreds of CEOs and executive directors are going through. It's quite startling to hear the impacts of the pandemic on our non-for-profit organizations. So merci à Sylvia et Sarana d'avoir partagé leurs histoires. Les exemples concrets des impacts du COVID sur vos organismes dressent le portrait de ce que plusieurs organismes sont en train de vivre en ce moment. Ceci conclut la partie formelle de la conférence de presse. So this concludes the formal part of the press conference. We're now open to taking questions. If journalists are interested in asking a public question, would you please put your name and your media in the chat. Si vous voulez poser une question, veuillez utiliser le chat de Zoom, puis commencez par écrire votre nom et votre média. And par la suite, les directeurs généraux, les présidences, les autres invités seront disponibles pour prendre des questions individuelles avec divers médias. So the speakers will also be available for interviews with the various media one-on-one if you would prefer. So do we have any questions from media? We don't have any requests for public questions. I assume that we were either very, very clear in our presentation. So thank you to our speakers. If media is interested, we can organize one-on-one interviews.
Moi, j'aurais une question. Maria Guimond, Radio-Canada.
OK, vas-y.
Ma question serait pour Monsieur Jolin. Peut-être Sylvia, en fait, j'aimerais avoir une réponse en français. Là. Vous parliez dans les solutions de modifier les critères du programme de subvention salariale. Pouvez-vous en parler davantage? Qu'est-ce que vous voulez qui soit changé exactement dans ces critères-là?
Bien, c'est pour un, c'est qu'on veut que nos organisations, les gens qui travaillent dans nos organisations puissent se qualifier pour ces programmes-là, parce que dans le moment, ce n'est pas le cas. Donc, il y a des modifications qu'on aimerait voir apportées. Je ne connais pas les détails de ce qu'on recherche de ce côté-là, parce que c'est, je veux dire, le bureau a travaillé avec les fonctionnaires à ce niveau-là pour parler justement de ce qu'on veut voir comme modification. Mais c'est officiel que, dans le moment, ça nous aide pas. Et puis, c'est important qu'il y ait des modifications qui doivent être apportées pour que nos gens puissent se qualifier, parce que c'est autant du côté des organisations que des gens qui ont travaillé, qui travaillent pour les organisations comme c'est là, on n'a pas accès.
Sylvia, veux-tu rajouter à la réponse de Carole? Sans doute que tu peux donner des exemples concrets de ce que tu vis sur le terrain.
Oui, tantôt je vous parlais de chiffres. Si je vous parle de chiffres par rapport à cette subvention-là, avec la grosseur du budget que je vous ai mentionné, ça représente une aide mensuelle d'à peu près 8 à 10 000 $ par mois chez nous, ce qui est à peu près rien sur la masse salariale que j'ai actuellement. Donc, je peux appliquer cette subvention-là seulement sur une petite partie de mon personnel. Donc, présentement, ça n'aide pas beaucoup la clé.
D'accord. Et peut-être question de rebond, là, vous avez mentionné que généralement, les OBNL francophones avaient une réduction de budget d'environ 80 000 $. Ça représente quoi exactement concrètement pour vous, 80 000 $ de moins?
Chez nous, c'est plus que 80 000 $ de moins. Comme je vous ai mentionné tout à l'heure, pour les trois premiers mois de la pandémie, nous avons subi une perte de 350 000 $ pour les trois premiers mois. Alors, nous, on est loin de ce pourcentage-là. On est actuellement en réouverture de services. On est environ à 10 % de nos capacités actuellement. Donc, vraiment, les prochains mois pour nous vont être déterminants.
D'accord. Merci.
Merci.
Oui. Oui, j'aurais une question, Rudy Chaban, ONFR+, pour Carole Jolin. Vous avez parlé dans les solutions, j'ai vu tout à l'heure, d'un fonds de stabilisation. Ça serait une des solutions. De quel ordre serait-il selon vous? Est-ce que vous avez évalué les besoins au niveau de ce fonds? Et est-ce que vous réclamez qu'il provienne des deux paliers du gouvernement?
Bien, pour un, les deux paliers de gouvernement doivent s'impliquer. C'est pas juste une question. Ça, c'est une question. C'est la responsabilité des deux paliers de gouvernement à voir justement ce que les organisations puissent travailler. Maintenant, Peter, si tu veux me rafraîchir la mémoire du côté, est-ce qu'on a mentionné des montants comme tels? Parce que dès le début, suite au tout premier sondage qu'on a fait paraître, Et puis, on a eu une grande réponse des organisations. Et puis, très, très tôt, on a commencé à travailler auprès des paliers de gouvernement pour les sensibiliser au fait que ça prend un fonds d'indemnisation parce que la plupart des organisations ne peuvent se qualifier pour les différents programmes gouvernementaux. Mais si, Peter, tu veux me rafraîchir la mémoire pour le montant, parce qu'il y a déjà des sommes qui sont arrivées du gouvernement fédéral, mais on sait que c'est nettement insuffisant pour être capable, justement, de permettre aux organisations, dans plusieurs cas, dans un cas sur cinq, de survivre à la pandémie.
Well, I'm actually going to pass that question to Kathy. Kathy, the question was, what are we specifically asking for in terms of investments from the federal and provincial governments?
Thank you so much for that question. When we, at the beginning of the pandemic, after the first couple of months, we put together, after talking to a number of organizations, and we did a survey early on. So we did a survey in April, and then this is our sort of follow-up survey, based on the number of organizations in Ontario that we required the provincial government to contribute $680 million to nonprofits and charities in terms of a stabilization fund. Which is a small percentage of the $3.8 billion that they had initially set aside for COVID relief to support nonprofits and charities in Ontario. And then at the federal government level, there was a number of organizations advocating to the federal government regarding the wage subsidy program and other programs. The gap across the country was around almost $10 billion. With some of those programs in place, I believe the request for the federal government is around $3.5 billion is the gap. And at the provincial level, it's $680 million.
Thank you, Kathy. Ça va, Rudy?
Oui. Oui. Donc, tout à l'heure, vous avez parlé aussi de force économique. Ces organismes ont présenté une force économique. Est-ce que ça veut dire que sans ces aides, les gouvernements ne la reconnaissent pas, cette force?
Carole, veux-tu commencer?
Pour un, ça fait partie du travail qu'on a à faire, en fait, de lobbying, justement, pour sensibiliser, informer les gouvernements du travail qu'on fait dans les organisations communautaires, parce que je ne suis pas certain que cette compréhension-là est là. On a un impact économique important. Cathy l'a mentionné, quelques 5 millions de personnes qui travaillent au niveau des OBNL. Du côté francophone, Sylvia vient de mentionner, elle est obligée de faire 32 mises à pied. Donc, toutes ces organisations-là qui donnent des services de toutes les sortes contribuent à l'économie de la province. Puis je pense que c'est mal connu et on a intérêt dans le travail que nous autres, on a à faire, ONN et puis nous autres, à travailler avec le gouvernement, s'assurer qu'ils comprennent bien, un, la situation et deux, comprennent l'impact qu'on a, puis pourquoi ils doivent travailler avec nous autres pour nous aider à remettre nos organisations sur pied. Ça va de la vitalité, de la pérennité, de la francophonie. Et il y a un autre élément aussi, c'est que si on commence à voir des organisations qui disparaissent, des organisations communautaires qui disparaissent, bien ça, c'est l'autoroute pour l'assimilation en Ontario, hein. Parce qu'à ce moment-là, il y a plusieurs, ces organisations-là contribuent à la vitalité de la francophonie dans leur coin de pays. Dans chaque endroit où ils sont. Et si on commence à en voir disparaître, c'est évident que ça va avoir un impact sur ce qu'on essaie de faire en Ontario, c'est-à-dire de faire la promotion du français puis de faire en sorte que la francophonie prospère.
Si je peux me permettre de faire du pouce sur le commentaire de Carole, je pense que c'est important. Oui, on parle de montant d'argent, mais un des éléments qui est très important, entre autres, pour moi, ce serait d'avoir un comité consultatif pour s'assurer que ce qu'on met en place répond vraiment aux besoins des organismes sans but lucratif. Actuellement, de toutes les mesures qui ont été mises en place, les seuls fonds pour lesquels on a accès présentement à la clé, c'est le fonds pour l'appui salarial. Tous les autres fonds qui ont été mis à la disposition, on ne qualifie pas. Donc, ça devient de s'assurer qu'on répond vraiment aux besoins différents des organismes sans but lucratif en Ontario.
Si je peux revenir sur ça, parce que Cathy avait parlé du comité consultatif tantôt, Sylvia vient de le soulever. C'est important que, nous, comme francophones, qu'on soit à cette table-là et puis qu'ils nous entendent et puis qu'ils aient l'occasion justement de prendre les mesures. Il faut que les mesures soient prises. Et puis, pour ça, bien, il faut être là. J'ai parlé de lobbying, comité consultatif extrêmement important. Ça va faire partie, justement, du lobbying qu'on va faire pour que ça soit mis ensemble et puis qu'on puisse communiquer avec nos dirigeants, mais qu'est-ce qui se passe?
Rudy, je veux juste rajouter qu'il y a quand même trois programmes qui ont été adaptés un peu pour les groupes francophones. Il y a un fonds à FEDDEB que l'APO gère. Il y a le fonds du PAPO qui est ouvert aussi à s'adapter aux besoins des groupes pour le COVID. Puis il y a le nouveau fonds de la Fondation Trillium. Kathy, the question is, was the journalist was asking if the governments were not doing their job adequately in ensuring that there are funds for the not-for-profit sector, is there not enough recognition of the impact and the contribution of the not-for-profit sector? There, I got there.
Yes, merci pour la question. I think it's one of the challenges that our sector has for sure is that we have thousands of organizations working in communities every day with, and they don't talk about their work. They don't spend their time advocating to government on the importance of what they do. They just simply do the work to meet their needs in the community. So I do think there is a lack of recognition among our levels of government about the impact that nonprofits and charities have, the gaps that would exist if nonprofits and charities did not provide these services in their communities, and also the economic impact. In Ontario, we employ 1 million people in the nonprofit sector, which is more than the automotive sector in Ontario. We have 5 million volunteers that leverage the value of those workers and do additional supports for our sector. So it's an important piece to continue to express to government how important our sector is, along with the private sector and the public sector, so the three stools, if you will, of the economy, and to pay attention to what the needs of our sector are. I often think of what would our communities look like without nonprofits and charities. There would be no minor sports organization, no arts and culture, no seniors programs, no mental health, no immigrant services, no friendship centers. It would be a pretty dismal and depressing place, and the cost for government would go through the roof because of the needs and the community needs that would increase as a result of nonprofits and charities not dealing with the issues and opportunities in their own communities. So I do think we need to play a stronger role with government to increase their understanding and recognition of how nonprofits and charities work. We don't rely on government handouts. In fact, half of the revenue for nonprofits and charities comes from earned income and fees for service. And the rest of and government revenue comes from all three levels of government. So we're not a sector that actually does rely on government handouts, but we do need government investment in a time of crisis.
Thanks, Kathy. And government's getting a lot of bang for their buck. Sarana, did you want to address that question?
Sure. Thank you, Peter. The nonprofit sector and Organization of Skills for Change are great partners to at all levels of government in delivery of critical programs and services. I think what's important for us to understand is though they have been investment, it's just not enough in order for us to be able to do the work we do and to do it well. And critically important is for us, for people to understand, as Kathy has mentioned, is the nonprofit organization and the infrastructure that we've built are critical to the government being able to meet the strategic mandate. Without us as partners to deliver the programs and services, a lot of Ontarians will not be able to have the quality of life that our governments want them to have. So we need to call on the government to be a lot more flexible in terms of how we're able to utilize the resources that they're giving us to steward and to deliver programs and services, and to recognize some of the additional costs and burdens that we do have in doing to deliver the programs and services. For example, we need a greater investment in PPE for frontline workers outside of healthcare. For example, my organization, we do in-person one-on-one employment services, settlement services, training, coaching, and you have to meet a lot of people. We serve 20,000 people per year. So all of our employees are meeting hundreds of individuals and community partners, one-on-one workshops, etc. And we have not received an investment to be able to purchase PPE. We have to figure out what extra dollars or unspent monies, if there are any, to buy critical equipment, to reconfigure our physical sites, to provide the same equipment to clients entering the centers without any new investments. That is very burdensome, and that puts our staff and our broader community at risk. And I think we need to understand that. Also, it's important that the government and also communities understand how nonprofits work. we are strategic partners to the various levels of government. We, as Karti said, we're not just get handout. We have metrics, we have deliverables, we add real value to our community, we add economic value, we add social value, and we need the government to recognize that and to be able to support this critical sector so that all of Ontario could benefit. And we need money. We need real money to be able to do that very well. We need additional training and tools for our staff so they can do their jobs very well because they are committed. They're deeply committed. And as a sector that is highly feminized and that a significant amount of the employees who work in this sector are women, we have additional pressures and burdens that women have with families and childcare that is not being considered. So I'm advocating on behalf of increased childcare supports for our clients. But I think we do have to shine a light on the importance of having additional investment in childcare for the workers in the sector who are delivering services because their children need to be taken care of. And there's not enough of an infrastructure. So I think we do need to have a deep investment that understands the value of the sector, the criticality of it to the government's mandate, and they must understand that we are partners in their work. We are partners, and partner needs to be treated a lot more equally and a lot more fairly so we can do the work that much more effectively.
Thank you, Sarana. We have time for maybe one more question, and I've also asked that the contact information for individual interviews be put in the chat for those media looking for a one-on-one interview. So, est-ce qu'on a une dernière question? We've had